The screwball comedy was one of the dominant comedic genres of the golden age of Hollywood. Designed to be satires of traditional romantic comedies, these films, known for their rapid-fire dialogue and farcical situations, challenged social taboos of the time.
Get out of here! Don't be on busy!
No, look, honey! Please, save
your breath. Look, this will bring us back together again, just the way we used to be.
That's just what I'm afraid of, any time, any place, anywhere.
Don't mock me. This is bigger than anything that ever happened to us. Don't do it for me. Do it for the paper.
Scram, Svengali.
What social taboos? Well, for one, screwball comedies typically skewered class warfare while reserving their sharpest satirical barbs for the perceived frivolousness and aloofness of the extremely wealthy. But perhaps most notably, screwball comedies tackled the subjects of sex and infidelity. The massively influential film critic Andrew Saris once described screwball comedies as sex comedies without the sex.
Hello, Mike.
Old Drew knew what he was talking about. From 1930 to 1968, American films were subject to censorship under a set of moral guidelines imposed by the Motion Picture Production Code, popularly known as the Hays Code, after Will H. Hays. Hays was the first president of the trade association, the Motion Picture Producers and Distributors of America, which would eventually become the Motion Picture Association of America, or the MPAA. If you've ever looked closely at a movie's rating, you've probably seen that acronym before. The MPAA is responsible for assigning films their rating based on any morally objectionable content. Basically, the MPAA is the organization responsible for telling your parents that you weren't allowed to see RoboCop in the theater because it was too awesome. While today, submitting a film to the MPAA, or the MPA as it's now called, to receive a rating is strictly voluntary, films released back in the early 20th century had to abide by decency laws, which were different in almost every state. So, the Hays Code was created as a way to standardize content guidelines for Hollywood films, to ensure that they could be screened in any town in America without breaking the law. In order to get around decency laws that forbade the explicit depiction of sex or infidelity, movies had to be clever. Screwball comedies replaced traditional sexual tension by having love interests trade witty barbs at a machine gun pace, and swept infidelity under the rug by having characters get divorced and remarried to their lovers, resulting in another subgenre known as a comedy of remarriage. Basically, a Hays-friendly version of a love triangle, like the one between Cary Grant, Katharine Hepburn, and Jimmy Stewart in George Cukor's 1940 screwball comedy The Philadelphia Story. We'll circle back to that film later. Cary Grant and Katharine Hepburn were the king and queen of screwball comedies. Separately, they appeared in several films of the genre, in part because their equally imitable mid-Atlantic accents were perfect for the screwball's signature rapid-fire wordplay.
You shouldn't do that, you know.
But what shouldn't I do?
Talk while someone's shooting.
Yes,
well, anyway,
I
forgive you because I got a good shot.
But you don't understand.
But together, they made three of the most memorable screwball comedies ever produced: Bringing Up Baby, Holiday, and The Philadelphia Story. In addition to being three standout examples of the genre, each film is entirely unique in its exploration of what a screwball comedy could be. Howard Hawks' 1938 film Bringing Up Baby contains elements of just about every subgenre of film comedy imaginable, including slapstick, masquerade, farce, absurdism, and situational comedy, the latter of which would become the bedrock of modern network television. Put a pin in that idea, we'll come back to it in a minute. In the film, Grant plays paleontologist Dr. David Huxley, who has spent the last 4 years assembling a brontosaurus skeleton and is waiting on the delivery of one final bone to complete the display. He needs to schmooze with a high society lawyer who represents Mae Robeson's fabulously wealthy Mrs. Elizabeth Random in order to secure a $1 million donation that his museum desperately needs. But he is waylaid by Mrs. Random's scatterbrained niece Susan Vance, portrayed by an irresistibly frenetic Katharine Hepburn. Susan proceeds to steal David's car and ruin his fancy dinner meeting through a series of increasingly madcap misunderstandings.
Oh, you've torn your coat.
Susan, mistakenly thinking David is a zoologist, calls him the next day to get his help wrangling a tame leopard named Baby that her brother sent from Brazil as a gift. Their misadventures continue to spiral further out of control through a series of farcical situations that culminate in almost the entire cast going to prison. Susan's flightiness finally comes in handy, and she saves the day with a well-timed scheme, only to accidentally demolish David's brontosaurus skeleton in the final scene. In addition to being a strong representative of comedies of its era, Bringing Up Baby contains several hallmarks of modern screwball comedies. Characters who behave like children, a wacky cast of supporting characters, a gentle, exotic animal who must be delivered from point A to point B, an attempt to infiltrate high society that reveals the upper class to be every bit as dumb as anyone else, and a small lie that quickly becomes unwieldy and must still be maintained. Even the basic idea of a well-meaning imbecile making a straight-laced character's life a living hell is a popular formula. Think the dynamic between Steve Martin and John Candy in Planes, Trains, and Automobiles.
You know, nothing grinds my gears worse than some chowderhead who doesn't know when to keep his big trap shut.
Bringing Up Baby represents the screwball comedy at its most absurd. It still takes place in the real world, but barely. The film's improbable series of events and goofy cast of supporting characters make it a borderline Marx Brothers adventure. Meanwhile, George Cukor's Holiday, released the very same year, is a more grounded film, closer to While You Were Sleeping or Sleepless in Seattle. In Holiday, Grant plays Johnny Case, a free-spirited goofball who falls in love with Doris Nolan's Julia while on vacation at Lake Placid. The two decide to get married, and Johnny goes to Julia's home in the city to meet her family and discovers that Julia is the youngest daughter of a millionaire banker. Cue record scratch.
This is too much.
Johnny meets the stuffy family patriarch Edward Seaton, who is only concerned with money and the pursuit of it. But you can see how this has made her siblings miserable. Julia's younger brother Ned, played by Lou Ayers, is an alcoholic, and her vivacious older sister Linda, played by, you guessed it, Katharine Hepburn, is a free spirit like Johnny, but she's trapped in the gilded cage of her family's wealth.
With this million-dollar museum, all those marble pillars down there?
Case, compared to the life I lead, the last man in a chain gang thoroughly enjoys himself.
The movie becomes an arms race of irreverence as the obvious attraction between Linda and Johnny builds, resulting in more than one scene of Cary Grant doing some impressive gymnastics. He was a manic pixie dream girl decades before Natalie Portman was in Garden State.
Blah, 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 blah.
Ultimately, Johnny realizes that Julia and her father want to put him in the same cage that Linda has been trapped in for so long, and the wedding is called off, which leaves the door open for Johnny and Linda to finally get together like we've been waiting for them to do all along. Out of the trio of movies we've discussed in today's video, Holiday is the most like a traditional romantic comedy, while still being an excellent example of a screwball film thanks to its love triangle dynamic and its withering commentary on the extremely wealthy. It also reverses traditional gender roles by having Johnny play the flighty, free-spirited role traditionally occupied by women, and by casting Julia as the more serious partner, with the lion's share of the power in the relationship. This is another signature element of screwball comedies that is further explored in The Philadelphia Story. Cukor's 1940 film, which interestingly, like Holiday, was also based on a Broadway play by Philip Barry, casts Hepburn as frigidly aloof socialite Tracy Lord, who is juggling no less than three different suitors: her image-obsessed fiancé George Kittredge, played by John Howard; hard luck writer Macaulay Mike Connor, played by Jimmy Stewart in an Oscar-winning performance; and her ex-husband C.K. Dexter Haven, played by Grant. The comedy in The Philadelphia Story is much more grounded than the other two films, but is still based on hallmarks of the screwball genre. Tracy lives a life completely concerned with image, and her blushingly wealthy family puts constant pressure on her to be perfect rather than allowing her to be herself. Mike and Dexter are pointedly critical of her old money surroundings, particularly Mike, who is a bitter fiction writer slumming it by writing a gossip piece about Tracy's family.
This is the voice of doom calling. Your days are numbered to the seventh son of the seventh son.
In addition to its commentary on the upper class, the film features Tracy in the power role of all three relationships.
Oh, we're going to talk about me, are we? Goody.
She's never not holding all the cards. Even though George makes a big show of being wounded after discovering her going on a relatively innocent midnight swim with Mike, she's the one who ultimately tells George to hit the road. And she dismisses Mike's impulsive marriage proposal in favor of getting remarried to Dexter, who is the only one of the three who actually understands and encourages her to shake loose her family's expectations and just be herself. Hey, there's that comedy of remarriage we talked about earlier. There's also an element of hidden identities, a common trope of farces and, consequently, of screwball comedies. Mike and his partner Liz, played by Ruth Hussey, attend Tracy's wedding to George disguised as friends of the family. But Dexter, who works for the same magazine and helped arrange the deception, reveals the truth to Tracy and her family almost immediately.
Wait, Red, wait.
Resulting in an amusing series of patronizing performances as the family continues to pretend as though they have no idea Mike and Liz are reporters. That's pure farce. And while The Philadelphia Story never gets as silly as Bringing Up Baby, it doesn't forget the genre's roots. Screwball comedies gradually went out of style in the 1940s and all but disappeared after the abandonment of the Hays Code in the 60s made them unnecessary. You don't need to be coy about sex in a cinematic landscape featuring movies like Porky's and Animal House. But screwball comedies have remained enduring classics of American movie making, and the genre's signature elements continue to influence comedy to this day.
I can't give you anything but love, baby. That's the only thing I can give you.